Hey everyone, I hope that y'all had a great week this week. I have some great environmental news to speak about and also want to address a number of other bills that we voted on this week. So let's jump right into it. As you know, I've been a huge advocate for protecting our public lands, preserving our water resources during my time here in Congress. This week we passed legislation to permanently reauthorize the Land and Water Conservation Fund, also known as LWCF, which has invested, it's invested about $1 billion across the state of Florida to conserve fish and wildlife habitats, to enhance public and hunting and fishing lands across the state, to restore the Everglades, all without spending a single taxpayer dollar. So it's really been an incredible effort. Now each year, our economy, it's driven by the millions of people who visit Florida, who go out there, they enjoy the outdoors, whether it's our beaches, whether it's the Everglades, whether it's down in the Keys or up in the Panhandle or, you know, in our area of the Treasure Coast. And more than that, our entire way of life, it's tied to preserving our public land and protecting our environment. It's been the big thing that we talk about on these videos week after week after week, what's going on with preserving our waterways specifically in our area. Now passing this bill, it was an important step to ensuring that our local water resources and public lands, including the Everglades, will be protected and preserved literally for generations to come. And I'm excited about that. It's on its way to the president's desk to be signed into law. Now, I also helped introduce another bill this week to tackle our local water issues. You know, again, I think you catch on to it, you know, a theme here. It's the thing that we eat, sleep, and breathe in this office is, you know, what can we do for our local water issues? And this one was particularly on non-point source pollution, which is the kind of pollution that comes from, runoff off different lands, also includes, you know, could include a leaky septic tank or more. It's what's generally referred to if there's not a pipe coming out of the ground that, you know, there's something specifically dripping out of that pipe. It's generally referred to as non-point source pollution. Those would kind of be the two differences between point source and non-point source. But the main driver of pollution that is fueling toxic algal blooms that have created our public health crisis. Now, our efforts to fix the water quality issues surrounding Lake Okeechobee, they need to start in two particular places, in my opinion. Number one, what are the source of nutrients and pollutions that we need to go out there and address? And that's one side of it. And the other side of it, what is the source of addressing where water is conveyed to? And those are separate issues. And sometimes we even divide those into three issues: water conveyance, freshwater discharges, and then freshwater discharges with nutrients. Those are all in their own right separate problems that we face in the area. So like I said, this one specifically starting at the source of non-point source pollution, preventing this non-point source pollution in different ways, and there's a number of ways that it can do this. So why this week I introduced this bill called the Bipartisan Local Water Protection Act? Because it increases the amount of authorized federal funding that's provided to prevent this agricultural runoff, if that's what occurs, or any other kind of runoff, wherever it comes from, other forms of non-point source pollution. It will help really any number of critical projects, including assisting with septic to sewer conversions. That's one of the places that this can be used. It can be used to go out there and assist with dredging legacy pollutants that are out of Lake Okeechobee, and combating the remaining effects of channelization of the Kissimmee River. These are all specific things that it can go out there and do. Now, with these bills, we're taking important steps in the right direction to clean up our waterways, to get below those maximum daily loads of nutrients. We don't want any nutrients going into the water, but to make sure that we get underneath those TMDLs, really help anything going on with any type of best management practice to come to fruition. You know, try to clean up those Florida waterways, water coming into Lake Okeechobee, water leaving Lake Okeechobee, going into any other direction, especially into our community. We want that water to be clean wherever it's going. We want clean Florida Everglades, and I think it's an issue that's worth every bit of fight that we have inside of us. Now, the Florida Congressional delegation also held a hearing this week with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, the Department of the Interior, the Florida Department of Environmental Protection, and several others. I spoke briefly about the myth that is shared adversity. This is a term that gets thrown around often. I've heard people say, well, there has to be shared adversity and shared prosperity. Well, right now, there is not shared adversity. When Lake Okeechobee levels are kept to a level where nearly every single year for the past 13 years, our coast and the West Coast gets these harmful deluge of discharges, that's not shared adversity. That's keeping the lake to a level that is clearly too high. If it's getting to an emergency point every single year, even years where we don't have hurricanes come anywhere close to hitting our area. Last year, we didn't have any hurricanes hit our area, but we had the better part of 3 months straight of discharges into our community, into the east coast of Florida. That tells you that the lake is being kept at too high of a level if it's getting to that emergency situation so easily that the Corps of Engineers has to discharge that water. That's putting all of the adversity onto the coastal communities, and it's only a hypothetical adversity in the other communities, and this is one of those things that we seek to fight. And it's also one of those things that is good for the communities south of Lake Okeechobee in one very big respect. One of the big arguments that's made in Lake Okeechobee management constantly, and I had a Palm Beach County Commissioner come up a couple weeks ago into Stewart, and she voiced this concern that, listen, we're worried about the lives of people south of the lake if that dike were to breach. And that is an equal concern to me as well. And that's where, when we think about not having those lake levels so high moving into hurricane season, that's the time of period that we're talking about. May 15th, the beginning of June, that beginning of hurricane season, making sure that we're taking those lake levels to the lower end of that Lake Okeechobee regulation schedule band. It's found on page 37 of LORS, figure 7-1. It shows this isn't an arbitrary number that we're asking for. We're asking to take it to the bottom of this band so that those communities south of the lake don't have nearly as much worry about the dike breaching. So that's a safety issue for them. When that lake level is brought lower just before the beginning of hurricane season, that's less likelihood that we take discharges throughout the summer into the East Coast because we're not getting to that emergency situation on the lake. And partially in working to get those lake levels lower, it allows the West Coast communities who most often in the winter months, they don't get the discharges that they actually want. They're not getting the quantity of fresh water that they want. And this year, they are getting that quantity of fresh water that they want. So it's a win on three different sides, and that's one of the reasons that we're really working for this change. There's a lot more to come on speaking about this issue. So all around, we made good progress this week, and I also want to say thank you again to all of you who came out to the Army Corps of Engineers public comment meetings last week in Stewart and other places. Could not be more proud of the way that our communities have come together to make our voice heard. Now I want to encourage you all to continue to keep up the fight, to keep up the comments. Go out there, speak to the Corps of Engineers, ask them the tough questions until the deadline on March 31 to get those questions in, and then continue asking them questions after that. But until then, you can continue to submit your public comments online, mast.house.gov/LORS, as well as an email to lakeocomments@usace.army.mil. Now, shifting topics. I also want to talk about a few bills that came up for a vote this week on Tuesday. I voted to defend the President's emergency declaration to protect our southern border. The Presidents of the United States of America, whether it's President Trump, President Obama, President Bush, President Clinton, President Bush, President Reagan, going on down the line, they have the power to declare a national emergency if they believe the nation is threatened by a crisis or an emergency circumstance. Now, unfortunately, we've seen rampant partisan resistance to fixing the problems on our southern border. And this effort, this is an effort that puts politics ahead of security. And it's dangerous. It's dangerous for all Americans. I think you've all heard me say before, we have a right, our number number one right as Americans to be protected, not just protect ourselves, but be protected by our government. That's the job of the government, certainly, to protect our borders, to protect our sovereignty. And if anybody has any doubt about whether there is a crisis at the border, President Obama even expressed his opinion, you know, in 2014, as did every other president. As I said, you know, President Bush expressed it, President Clinton expressed it, and on down the line. They've all expressed the urgency, the humanitarian crisis, the existential threat that exists on our southern border. And I agree that there is a crisis, which is why I strongly support that emergency declaration. And I voted in opposition to the attempts to prevent this declaration from moving forward. Now, in my opinion, it is irresponsible to play political games with our southern border while countless Americans are impacted by illegal drugs, by illegal immigration, by human trafficking. These are the three biggest prevalent crimes that are coming across our border, beyond just the most obvious of somebody crossing our border illegally. Now, I'm going to continue to fight to strengthen our border security, including building a wall at our southern border so that we can protect our national security. Now, also this week, the House of Representatives passed a bill called the Bipartisan Background Checks Act of 2019. This is a bill that I've heard from a lot of people on, some in support, some not in support, but the thing that I always ask of people is take these bills for what's in front of you. I quite often get it when you know, we're having discussions and debates about these bills, that sometimes people want to call, you know, the way I put it, they want to call a giraffe hippopotamus, or vice versa. We have to take these pieces of legislation for what they are. When we write something in black and white, in black ink on white paper, and it passes through the House and passes through the Senate and goes to the President's desk, what it says is the law, not something outside of that. And so I always ask for, you know, fair and honest debate in this. Now, what this bill very simply says is that the background check that every firearm store that has been doing background checks for years to check for criminal history, all those brick and mortar stores, that's where I go and purchase all of, you know, the firearms that I have, that I collect, that I go out there to shoot and hunt with, you know, I go and purchase them from a brick and mortar location. The background check that they run on me, that background check has to be run everywhere. Now, what is that background check for? It checks simply for criminal history. That's what it checks for. It checks to say, you know, are you on parole for rape? Are you on parole for manslaughter? You know, do you have a violent criminal felony in your past that prevents you from legally purchasing a firearm? And when somebody goes to one of those brick and mortar gun stores and they come back on that National Instant Criminal Background Check system and it says, no, you came back, the FBI said you have a pass that says you can't purchase a firearm, then they are prevented from purchasing a firearm. It's a very good system at those brick and mortar locations. And in that, along with several other important exemptions to this bill that do protect certain people from not having to go through the background check, this bill says that people need to have background checks when they purchase firearms. Now, no background check is needed. I want to be clear about this because there's been a lot of questions about who doesn't need a background check. Number one, no background check is needed for a gift from a family member, right? So a grandparent giving a firearm down to a son or daughter, grandson, granddaughter, a parent passing a firearm down to, you know, one of their children, step-parents, you know, aunts, uncle to their family. No background check is needed for that type of gift, or gifts between siblings, not required. Second, no background check is needed for transfers of firearms for somebody that's loading a firearm when they're out hunting or shooting at a range, or if there's a situation where there's need of self-defense. Say I have two pistols on me, say I have two Glocks on me, I normally carry one, say I have two on me and I get into a dangerous situation and one of my friends doesn't have a firearm on them, not usually like most of my friends, they usually do, but I give them one of mine. There doesn't have to be a background check in that situation of imminent danger to loan them a firearm. And like I said, hunting and, you know, out at the range and things like that. Third, there's a section that I included that says absolutely, it absolutely prohibits any type of firearms registry. There's a lot of people say that this is a firearms registry. It's not. It's absolutely not a firearms registry. In fact, if somebody were to make a registry out of doing a background check, they would actually be breaking the law by creating a registry. That would be breaking the law. I always tell people, when you're doing a background check, the background check doesn't care how many firearms you're purchasing. It cares what's your name, what's your address, what's your social security. Doesn't care everything else about the firearms. It cares what is your history. That's what it's checking. Do you have a criminal past? And that's it, period. It's not any type of registry. I also successfully included a provision that will be a huge improvement in the fight against illegal immigration if this bill were to become law. And this is where there was really some amazing partisan political arguments that were so not above board. It was amazing to me to hear the debate on this. Now, anytime, this was the provision, anytime an illegal immigrant attempts to purchase a firearm and they go through a criminal background check, this provision would say that ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, will be immediately notified so that they can take the important and necessary steps to go out there and prevent these illegal immigrants from purchasing a firearm. Now, what was the very partisan part about that? It was amazing how much Democrat opposition, all the debate that I heard about this from the Democrat side talking about, listen, we need to prevent criminals from purchasing firearms, and I believe in that. But to me, it was very, very disingenuous when nearly no Democrats fought to see the provision included that says we also need to alert Immigration and Customs Enforcement if an illegal immigrant is attempting to purchase a firearm. House Democrats didn't want to see that crime prevented. And that was very disingenuous. I'm glad we were able to still get this into the piece of legislation because that's an important part of it. Now, I believe that this bill, it's important so that people who are on parole, as I said, for rape or assault or manslaughter or some other violent crime, who fail a background check at a store, they can't come to my back door or somebody else's back door and purchase a firearm that they were otherwise precluded from purchasing. They do not run a background check because they don't run a background check, or I don't run a background check, or somebody else doesn't at the back door. This is what that is addressing. Now, at the same time, this bill includes strong protections for the Second Amendment, which I care about deeply. As many of you have been out to the range to me, you've been out with shoots with me, some of you have been out hunting with me. You've been out there shooting with my children. Some of you have seen my collection of firearms, and we've grown up doing this. This is something that I care about deeply, but it's also something that I care about making sure that, if we have a law that's good, that says criminals shouldn't be able to purchase firearms, and this is how we enforce it, that it be enforced on all accounts. Now, I've also voted against a different bill, same similar issue, and that was known as HR 1112. And that would have arbitrarily extended a 3-day waiting period to purchase a firearm to a minimum of 10 days, and oftentimes much longer if the purchaser needs to file an appeal. I don't support arbitrary changes to policy in this kind of way. I didn't vote for that piece of legislation. I thought it was a very bad piece of legislation. My view on this is that if we retreat to our partisan corners and refuse to engage thoughtfully with each other, then we are doing a huge disservice to our country. So I'm going to step back and talk about that one provision again that was included in this bill about illegal immigration, if an illegal immigrant has a criminal background check, a NICS check, and it comes back that they're illegal. Nearly every Republican voted to say, yes, that's a good background check. We should have those background checks all the time. And if that person comes back illegal, that should be reported to ICE immediately. And nearly no Democrats voted in favor of saying that, and vice versa. And that's what I'm talking about in terms of retreating to our partisan corners. Let's look at each of these on the merits of what they do, and let's have honest and open debate. As you all know, you can always call me and speak to me about these debates. I debate with you all often. Sometimes it's on Facebook or Facebook Messenger or in text or on the phone or wherever. But truthfully for me, it's one of the best and most fulfilling and important parts of being able to be your representative. It's that debate that we have with one another, especially when it's fair and honest debate that we're having, and we're, you know, both sides are really trying to understand the issues. I enjoy that. I enjoy it probably almost more than anything else that I get to do in this work, is that debate that I get to go out there and have with you all, learn from you all, and hopefully some things that you take away from me and you learn about the legislation that we're working on. So I always appreciate that. And as I said, that's why I think this is how we help make real progress, and real progress in protecting things like the Second Amendment and all of our right to go out there and keep and bear arms. So in that, I just want to tell you all that I hope you all have a great week ahead. I hope that you all have a great weekend as well. I got to be out to the St. Lucie County Fair this past weekend, you know, with my kids, with my family. We might end up back out there this weekend as well. The kids always have a great time out there. Haven't been out there, I encourage you, get out there. Have a blast. Always a good time. And in that, I look forward to seeing you all around. Wish you the best.